Thank you. Could I ask those members who are leaving the chamber to now do so quickly and quietly, as we will now go to our last bit of business for the day, which is a members' business debate on motion 13753 in the name of Audrey Nicol on celebrating the Federation of Small Businesses' 50th anniversary. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Audrey Nicol to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to bring this debate to Chamber today, celebrating the 50th anniversary of the Federation of Small Businesses. And I'm grateful to colleagues for signing the motion and to those who are speaking today, and I look forward to hearing their contributions. But firstly, I want to acknowledge that we're having this debate straight after Chamber has been updated on the closure of the Grangemouth refinery, and I was pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary acknowledge the impact that this will have on small businesses across Scotland. And I know that organisations like the Federation of Small Businesses will stand ready to offer as much support as they can. And talking of the Federation of Small Businesses, I'm delighted that we're joined this afternoon by colleagues from the FSB, David Groundwater, Stacey Dingwall, Ewan McGrory, and of course Colin Borland. So it's nice to see you in the gallery. And I want to also extend my thanks to Mike Duncan, North East Scotland Development Manager, whose support has been invaluable to me, in particular during my recent small business spotlight that I will say more about shortly. So can I shamelessly dedicate today's debate to my dad, a greengrocer in Aberdeen, who, like many small business owners, worked long hours, supported a local supply chain, and most of all, knew his community like the back of his hand. And if you're listening, Dad, I always thought you massively undercharged for fresh Perthshire strawberries every summer. Founded in 1974, the Federation of Small Businesses was established in response to an increase in national insurance for self-employed workers by the then Labour government. And this has since been repealed, and now, 50 years later, the FSB is the UK's leading business campaigner and has proven to be a powerful voice to government through their policy work and political engagement. FSB members not only benefit from their cross-party campaigning, but also from other services they provide, including tailored support, research, financial expertise, and specialist advice. And today in Scotland, small businesses make up almost the entirety of the economy, around 98%. And these 335,000 businesses employ around 900,000 people with a turnover of £82 billion annually. Scotland's population of small businesses and self-employed are resilient, diverse and innovative. From traditional retailers and grocers like my father, to carbon capture technologists and spaceports, today's small businesses are continuing Scotland's long history of innovation and invention. And almost half of small businesses now work from home in areas such as professional, technical, and scientific activities. Digital nomads are increasing in number, offering business owners the flexibility to travel while working remotely by accessing technology and the internet. And my constituency of Aberdeen South and North Kincardine has an amazing variety of small businesses. And over recess, my summer business spotlight was the perfect excuse to visit some of them. FarmStop, an expansion of a busy working farm, offering animal interaction or lots of cuddles with piglets and lambs, and the inspiration of Christina and Tom. Megan Faulkner, creating unique silver jewellery at the amazing Demouth Artist Studios, and the Bread Guy, selling artisan breads and cakes across the city, created by local lad Gary McAllister. And I wanted to get into the detail of local businesses' plans to grow and diversify. What's working in that space, but what are the challenges too? What was apparent was that the Scottish Government's small business bonus scheme was, and I quote, a lifesaver for many businesses. Having the confidence and means to diversify also enabled businesses to react to changing consumer behaviour and adapt and expand their offer accordingly. However, it is a reality that for many businesses, small businesses, Brexit has been extremely damaging, restricting export opportunities, increasing costs and forcing small businesses to source materials from cheaper overseas markets. For one business, planning was creating a blockage in their expansion plans. For another, accessible to affordable studio space to expand her Scottish knitwear business may see her leave Scotland. Now, on a positive note, we cannot talk about support for small businesses without acknowledging their presence in the energy supply chain right across Scotland and especially across the North East, creating vital job opportunities and helping grow our economy. And not just those working in the hard hat space, but also events planners, lawyers, architects, programmers, digital content developers, and so many more. And I'm particularly pleased to note the Programme for Government outlines a commitment to supporting women, starting and scaling businesses, and to supporting our universities continue world-leading research and innovation that lays the foundations for small business development right across Scotland. And under the Scottish Government's Scottish Growth Scheme, businesses can access financial support through a number of initiatives such as the DSL Business Finance, Business Loan Scotland and Techstart Ventures. And it is initiatives such as the ones provided by the Scottish Government that will help grow micro and small businesses and allow for innovation within their respective sectors. Despite the economic conditions following Brexit and the COVID-19 pandemic, the Small Business Index reports that in the first quarter of 2024, the number of small businesses expecting their performance to improve over the coming quarter was at its highest level since 2022. And this certainly shows encouraging signs of recovery. However, in order to take full advantage of this, the FSB have made it clear that the Scottish Government need to continue to prioritise measures aimed at economic growth. And even in the current challenging fiscal environment, I'm confident that this will happen. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scotland's small businesses will always remain important to our economy and to local communities also. The Federation for Small Businesses recognises this and have been a great asset to small businesses right across Scotland. For half a century now, the FSB have armed their members with necessary knowledge and tools to help them grow and create a sustainable business. And likewise, the FSB have been a powerful voice in government, championing positive change for small businesses. So moving forward, I'm very much looking forward to working alongside the FSB to ensure I'm playing my part in supporting my local small businesses. And I'm joining them next month at a business networking event in my constituency. So in closing, I again congratulate the Federation of Small Businesses on their 50th anniversary, and I look forward to their future contributions over the next 50 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Nicol. I now call Claire Hawkey to be followed by Murdo Fraser. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms. Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And my thanks also to Audrey Nicol for bringing this debate to Parliament today to celebrate the Federation of Small Businesses' 50th anniversary. Over the past 50 years, the FSB has grown to become the UK's largest membership organisation for small businesses and the self-employed. They provide their members with vital services, including access to finance, business banking, legal advice and specialist support to help their businesses flourish. Now, last year, my Rutherglen constituency alone was home to around 2,000 registered businesses, the vast majority of which are small businesses of all varieties. And these small businesses are the lifeblood of Scotland's economy and the backbone of our communities across the country. And many small businesses are flourishing because of the uniqueness of what they can offer, despite the competition from multinational companies and superstores. Small businesses keep our high streets alive and provide a variety of bespoke and artisan services and personal service which large companies cannot compete with. And they are not just sources of employment, but places where people can meet, socialise and form deeper connections within their communities. Presiding Officer, in my own constituency, the control panel in Rutherglen was established over 24 years ago as a supplier of computer equipment repair and upgrading services. They provide a much valued personal service, not only using their expertise to keep customers' IT equipment running smoothly, but offering bespoke custom PCs built from the case up. Strachan's Craft Butchers in Blantyre have been in operation for 7 years and were at the end of last year named Training Partner of the Year at Industry Awards, honoured for their commitment to staff progression and supporting apprentices. And the Wee Gurkha Curry House is a Nepalese restaurant which opened earlier this year in Blantyre. It's an award-winning family-run business which had previously been based in East Kilbride but moved to their new larger premises. And they've quickly established themselves as a much-loved and appreciated local business. These are just three examples of small business in my constituency, all at different stages of their development, who make up our community and make communities what they are. Other small businesses not only are making an impact on the local economy and providing jobs in our communities, but they're making their mark on the world. Wat Laser in my constituency are a small business who are becoming leaders in their field and they export all around the world. And they're so close to the cutting edge of technology that some of the equipment they demonstrated when I visited them recently is one of a kind. SMEs are often embedded in the communities they operate in too, from non-profit-making entities like credit unions, and I could name First Class and Thistle Credit Unions in my constituency, to businesses like MDH Recruitment, whose social values see them donate to many local causes, to working with local schools and supporting our young people, or sponsoring local and youth sport. Resilient, productive businesses are, of course, the bedrock of Scotland's economy, which is why I strongly welcome Helping Businesses Succeed being at the heart of this year's programme for government. Indeed, in this, for example, are particular actions around increasing the number of women creating and scaling businesses and widening participation from other groups that are underrepresented, a cause championed by my constituent, Bailey Adeoti, herself a successful entrepreneur. These are also priorities for the FSB, further underlining the valuable role they play in supporting their members. Small businesses thrive when they are well supported to do so, and our wider communities thrive when they are doing well. I commend the work of the FSB towards this aim, and I wish them well for the future.
Thank you, Ms Huffey. I now call Murdo Fraser to be followed by Daniel Johnson. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I congratulate Aldrin Nicol on her motion and for securing this debate? And I'm sure we'll see a lot of consensus across the Chamber about the valuable work being done by the Federation of Small Business, celebrating the remarkable anniversary of 50 years in business themselves. Scotland is well served by a range of business organisations. We have the CBI in Scotland, we have the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, we have a whole range of sector bodies like the Scottish Tourism Alliance, the Scottish Licensed Trade Association, the Scottish Retail Consortium, the Scottish Grocers Federation, and many, many more. And we welcome the inputs from all these different trade bodies. But I think it's fair to say that few of these have the reach and the policy contribution that the Federations of Small Business has given us over the many years that they've been practicing, and in particular, the input into the work of this Parliament over the past 25 years. And it's been my pleasure to work with the FSB over a number of years and work with changing members of staff. And I, like Aldrin Nicol, I welcome to the gallery tonight representatives of the FSB and recognise the valuable work they have done. Aldrin Nicol was quite right to point out the importance of small businesses, making up 98% of the economy. And they are absolutely vital to our economic future as a nation. We have been lobbied over the years by the FSB, and indeed they've been lobbying us today in terms of the contribution they've made to the debate around a range of issues. Lobbied us around issues like business rates, around taxation, around regulation, around access to skills and the importance of infrastructure. And I was very interested to read, and Audrey Nicol referred to this, that the origin of the FSB was in lobbying against what they saw as unfair increases in national insurance for the self-employed by the UK government back in 1974, a successful campaign because that was then later repealed by the government. I just want to mention just two issues that are very relevant to the work of the FSB. And the first is something that Audrey Nicol referred to, the small business bonus scheme. And I can well remember the genesis of this particular policy. It was something campaigned for by the FSB over a number of years. It was something that was in the Conservative manifesto back in 2007. It was something that was in the SNP manifesto. And we worked together. Not something that happens very often these days, but the Conservatives in opposition worked together with the new minority SNP government in 2007 to bring in the small business bonus scheme. We were in opposition pushing the SNP to go further than they originally intended. And there was that shared ambition with two parties across this chamber to ensure that the small business bonus scheme was introduced. And it has been successful and has continued ever since, worth thousands to small businesses across Scotland. And we have many debates in this chamber, and we all recognise the issue of the decline of retail and the decline of traditional high streets. And I would say that that situation would be many times worse were it not for the small business bonus scheme, allowing small businesses to continue to trade from retail premises in our local high streets, in our towns and villages. And I know there is a debate around this. I know there will be some in this chamber who will argue that the small business bonus scheme is not good value for money, that it should be scrapped. My view is it is vitally important to small business and vitally important to the health of our retail centres, and I would be very reluctant to see the end of the small business bonus, a real success story of FSB. And the other thing, Presiding Officer, I'll mention very briefly is the issue of regulation, because FSB have been very effective at pushing back against excessive regulation of small business. We've seen new laws brought in, the deposit return scheme, the regulation of short-term lets, restrictions on alcohol sales and marketing, where there's not been a rigorous assessment of the impact on small businesses, where the FSB have been quite right to highlight their concerns about this. We certainly, on this side of the chamber, will continue to articulate those issues and concerns they raise. So to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's been a very successful first 50 years for the Federation of Small Business, and I look forward to working with them over the next half century ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Fraser. I now call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Pam Goslow. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I too congratulate Audrey Nicol and thank her for bringing forward this debate, because it gives us a fantastic opportunity to celebrate not just the 50th anniversary of the FSB, but talk about the critical work that they do, but more importantly and more broadly, the importance of small business to our economy and to our communities. And I probably should at this point make my declaration of interest. I am a one-time small business owner. I'm currently a director and also sometime member of the FSB. So the importance of this debate is one that is not just of policy interest to me, but personal interest. And I think that's perhaps, I think, the most important thing I would want to say. And can I thank Audrey Nicol for highlighting her own personal connections with a family business, being the daughter of a grocer. You know, there are other daughters of grocers we might not want to mention, but from other sides of the chamber. But clearly that is a personal connection. It's one that I share. As a child of a small business, childcare often meant occupying myself in a stockroom. I enjoyed playing with price guns as a child. I'm very happy to give way.
Audrey Nicol.
I thank the member for taking my intervention, and I thank him for his very kind comments. But I think the point that we've perhaps both tried to make this afternoon is about the people behind businesses. So probably many people in chamber here today, for example, have got friends, family members who work in small businesses, and it's important to recognise the people behind, the hard-working people behind businesses.
Daniel Johnson.
I couldn't have put it better myself, because I think this is one of the mistakes that we can often make about thinking about businesses all being about big business. Now, big business has a really important role, but small business is about people. And it's often small business is very personal. And it can be frustrating, it can be lonely. Decisions can be difficult because it's only you there to make those decisions. But it can also be exciting and rewarding. You get to work with other people. And critically, and we've already heard this from a number of members, including Claire Haughey and others, that small businesses are very often at the very heart of communities. You take small business out of those communities, and what are you left? Because small businesses are the ones that provide people with their day-to-day needs. They provide human contact, very often a source of local information. So I think we need to take small business more seriously, and there are some things that we need to really look at. Our birth rate of businesses is slightly lower in Scotland than the rest of the UK. I think we should be asking, how can we encourage more people to go into business? Likewise, and this is an issue right the way across the country, our growth rate for small businesses is slightly lower than many other countries in similar countries. So we need to ask ourselves why that is. What more can we do? And I think Murdo Fraser made a good point about regulation. We do really need to think about whether regulation is helping small business or does it get in the way. And critically, has small business been thought about at the forefront when regulation is thought about? Are our support mechanisms and our support agencies, are they appropriate for small businesses? There's a much more I think we can do in terms of helping small businesses adopt technology, access the skills regime. But we also look at investment. Very happy to give way.
Does Daniel Johnson agree that perhaps our Parliament could spend more time discussing the very questions that he is usefully raising in this debate and spend less time on some of the other issues we discuss in this place?
Daniel Johnson.
Let me give the half-full version. Absolutely, I think we should be talking more about small business, because small business is at the heart of communities, but I think it can also be at the heart of growth in the economy. Investment is undoubtedly difficult for small business, and I think we need to look at whether we can do more to support through government-backed investment, but also other things that we can do to help private investment and indeed help businesses develop skills for self-investment. Procurement needs to be, we time and time again, and we hear it very often and very frequently from the FSB, often just incompatible with the realities of running a small business, and we need to provide that access. But above all else, and I think my overarching message is, I encourage all members to engage with their small businesses, and as we pass laws and think and engage with policy, let's make sure there's much greater understanding of small businesses, because that way I think we can have stronger communities and a stronger economy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. And I now call Pam Gozo to be followed by Christine Graham. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms. Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before beginning my speech, I would like to take a moment to congratulate the Federation of Small Businesses for its 50th anniversary and welcome them to the Chamber as well. And I'd also like to thank all the organisations who have provided briefings for this debate today, as well as thanking Audrey Nicol for bringing such an important debate to the Parliament. Like Audrey, my mother and late father started from a small grocery business in the West End of Glasgow in the 1970s, so I too well know the importance of small businesses, not just to the economy, but to the communities as well. Established in 1974, the FSB has been the leading voice of 5.5 million small businesses across the United Kingdom. It helps small businesses and the self-employed succeed by offering them advice, financial products and support. The FSB's mission is to help smaller businesses survive through these difficult times and ultimately achieve their ambitions. The FSB's principal objectives include being fully representative of the whole UK small business community, providing support, advice and practical solutions to small businesses, advocating on behalf of small businesses by providing a powerful voice heard by governments and key decision makers, and managing financial resources in a manner that ensures best value for members. Currently, almost 335,000 SMEs are operating in Scotland, accounting for 98% of the private businesses. They employ around 900,000 people and account for a turnover of $82 billion annually. I have been an MSP for over now 3 years, and through this time I have championed small businesses in my local area through visits, questions, speeches, motions and through highlighting campaigns such as Shop Local, Scotland Loves Local Week and Small Business Saturday. Since last year, I have been running my own small business awards to celebrate the best small businesses locally. Some of last year's winners included Number One Boutique, an owner-led business selling unique clothing and going online for the first time during COVID to survive, Gavin's Mill Fair Trade Shop and Cafe, specialising in organic foods and home baking, which also has many volunteers supporting it, and many more great businesses that, unfortunately, I don't have the time tonight to mention. The COVID-19 pandemic and the cost of living crisis has presented challenges for Scotland's SMEs. Lack of access to cash and to financial support means that many SMEs are forced to shut down or be sold off. It is disappointing that instead of mirroring the previous Conservative UK government in passing a 75% business rate relief, the SNP ministry here in Holyrood have decided to punish businesses. Figures released by ONS have shown that between September 2022 and September 2023, there has been an 8% fall in the total number of retail jobs in Scotland, accounting for around 29,000. Therefore, had the Scottish Government passed on the rate relief for the Scottish businesses, these losses could have been mitigated. Some other actions the SNP Government could undertake to help small businesses are by maintaining small business bonus scheme at least its current threshold, by ensuring that any further regulation do not stifle small business ability to grow, by tackling the issue of late payments, and by creating opportunities for further growth. Therefore, I would hope the Minister in his closing speech offers much needed support to small businesses across Scotland. In closing, Presiding Officer, I would once again like to congratulate the FSB on their 50th anniversary and for an excellent work they do. Here's to another 50 years.
Thank you, Ms Gozo. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Douglas Ross. Around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I too congratulate the member on securing this debate, but most importantly, congratulate the FSB on its 50th anniversary. You can imagine in my constituency of Midlothian, South Tweeddale and Lauderdale, the vast majority of businesses are SMEs, small and medium-sized businesses, which indeed reflects the position throughout Scotland, and they are indeed the backbone of our economy. These are businesses embedded in the communities, employing locally, the spending of their employees often in the local economy, their commitment local. I celebrate small businesses from the Gala local painter and decorator who painted my office, the glazier who installed the windows, and to the many other businesses and shops. And I suppose I'm also a small business in Gala, where I've been since 1999. It was hard for all of them before COVID, what with austerity. COVID was dreadful, but thankfully with help from the UK and Scottish governments, many managed to stagger on. Indeed, the central bar in Peebles in the Northgate in Peebles, a free house, received no support as the premises was too small to accommodate the necessary hot food to access support. But Roddy Mackay, the owner of this wee friendly gem, buckled down, redecorated, smartened up the pub frontage, and indeed recently won an award for the floral display. That's resilience of a small business embedded in the community. But we still have austerity and the fallout from COVID, with many changed shopping habits. In businesses, work patterns have changed. Home working was an exception. Now it can be the norm, but this impacts on how businesses operate while still having the same outlays in rental, in heating, and so on. And indeed, we know how retail has changed, with shopping online no longer occasional or marginal. COVID changed that for good. Now, here I refer to the impact of the Small Business Bonus Scheme. I was here when it was brought in 2007 in agreement with the Conservatives to support the then SNP budget. And it was referenced by Murdo Fraser and others. It was a good idea at the time, and I support it today. For example, there are in 2023 figures in Midlothian, 1,060 businesses benefit from 100% relief, pay nothing, and where another 870 have a measure of relief. In Borders, 5,170 pay no rates under the scheme, 5,280, a measure of relief. Turning to support, the FSB provides this in financial expertise and other support, and of course, speaking up for small businesses to governments here and at UK level, and indeed to the local MSP if required. My door is always open. But local people can do their bit. For example, and I know Pam Godsell referred to Scotland Loves Local Week, which began on the 26th of August. Well, I shop anyway, so that was no challenge for me. So there is Ayla Bells in the Pennycook precinct with a wonderful upmarket array of Scottish goods. Now, the precinct does have footfall, but I laid down the gauntlet to Shelley, the owner, about going online when I'm sure she could increase sales. I told her I'd be checking up on her progress. I also directed her to the Business Gateway to assist in setting her website. This is a problem for sole owners. They're so busy, they sometimes can't do the stuff they need to expand. And she does need help for that because it makes a world of difference. Then there is, wait for this name, Fifi LeBonc at School Bray Peebles. What a name and apposite. Exotic, idiosyncratic, that's just the owner. As well as the clothes she makes individually and designed. Again, websites help with that kind of very esoteric and, if I may say so, even for me, offbeat designs, but staggeringly interesting. In both of these, I made lovely purchases. I may wear them in here at some point. And I encourage communities to be mindful, even in these tough times. Oh, by the way, I paid for them myself, just to put that on the record. To support local businesses and shops as best they can. And as others have said, and this is a serious point, isn't it? They are the lifeblood of our communities. They are embedded. They feel indebted and they feel responsible to the communities where they are, and therefore keep our high streets and town centres under such pressure today alive and kicking. So finally, I return to congratulating FSB on its special anniversary and my colleague on securing this debate, and if I may say so, all the small and medium enterprises in my constituency. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I now call Douglas Ross to be followed by Lorna Slater. Around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I too congratulate Audrey Nicholl on securing this important debate. I was particularly keen to contribute today to thank the FSB for the support they've given me, and I know all politicians, since I've entered elected office. They have been a constant both nationally and locally, feeding in ideas for manifestos or bringing forward suggestions that we could take forward on a local level. As a government minister and as party leader, they were one of the regular groups that I would meet with to hear from them the concerns of their members, what their members were looking for, and what they felt parliamentarians across the political spectrum could deliver for them. And that's why I think over the last 50 years, they have built themselves into an organisation which every single political party respects and listens to and hopes to bring on board many of their suggestions. So at national level, they have played a crucial role, but I also want to speak about what they have done with me and others at a local level. And I was reminded by Mike Duncan, who I spoke with earlier today, about some of their involvement locally in Moray, and I know the Minister will touch on this as well. Back in 2010, we had the terrible decision to close RAF Kinloss at the time and the potential for RAF Lossiemouth to close. And when a task force was brought together with Moray Chamber of Commerce, the Council, elected representatives, the FSB was a vital part of that as well, because they spoke for the small businesses, particularly close to Kinloss and Forres and the surrounding towns, about the impact that closure would have and the double impact if we were to also lose Lossiemouth. Well, Lossiemouth was not only retained because of that campaign that FSB were part of, we've also got Kinloss Barracks, and in fact Lossiemouth has increased its presence in the local economy, and that is thanks to the efforts of everyone on that task force, including the FSB. Another area where I think they provided an invaluable role was during the COVID pandemic. So we had weekly meetings online in Moray with various different organisations. And I have to say, David Groundwater was an absolute force of nature. He seemed to be on every single call we were involved in. And he was looking particularly at the impact that we were facing
on decisions taken at a UK level or at a Scottish level that might have been slightly different, or indeed even in the North East, where we had some councils doing it one way and other councils doing things another way. So not only were they quickly digesting new legislation and rules and enforcement practices, they were putting that out to their members, but also feeding back to members of Parliament, both at Westminster and at Holyrood, what was going well and what could be improved, and I think that was crucial. And most recently, Mike Duncan, as our area representative, the development manager for Moray, Teesside and the North East, sits on the Elgin Town Fund. This is a £20 million fund by the UK government to invest in Elgin. It's not been recommitted to by the current Labour government, but I hope it will be, because it has an opportunity to really drive forward investment in Elgin, and again, the FSB have a crucial role to play in that. And finally, I couldn't speak in a debate about the Federation of Small Businesses here in Parliament without mentioning another person who has been long associated with the FSB in Moray and nationally, and that is Pearl Hamilton. Pearl Hamilton has tirelessly worked on behalf of members in Moray and across the country, part of the policy development of the FSB, and was recently, earlier this year, made a Burgess of Forres. And in the citation for Pearl becoming a Burgess of Forres, part of that was not just the work she does in her shop at Pearl's Pet Care, the work she's done for local charities, helping OEPs and getting volunteers to help out in the community. It was the fact that, as the citation says, she has been and continues to be a major force in the Federation of Small Businesses. It is right tonight that we celebrate 50 years of the FSB nationally. We celebrate people like Pearl who have worked hard both as a business owner themselves but wanting to contribute to the work of the FSB, and we look forward to the next 50 years. And finally, if I can, Presiding Officer, well, I think we will get unanimity in the debate tonight about praising the FSB. Perhaps the greater gift we can give to the Federation is to encourage all of our constituents to use their small businesses. They are the lifeblood of our towns, our villages and our communities, and we have to encourage people to continue to use our small businesses because they provide so much for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Ross. Before I call the next speaker, I would advise members that due to the number of members who have sought to speak in this debate and who are still to speak, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I now invite Audrey Nicholl to move a motion without notice.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Nicholl. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. And I now call Lorna Slater to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Slater.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to bring members' attention my register of interests. At the time of my election, I was working for Orbital Marine Power, a small tidal energy company which has about 30 members of staff. I have a combined degree in electrical and mechanical engineering design, which you'd probably call mechatronics these days. This was a reasonably new idea 30 years ago when I started university. I can't actually believe that's how long it is. The idea behind it was to create engineers specifically to support smaller technical businesses who couldn't afford separate mechanical, electrical, and software engineering departments. I'm a machine builder. Throughout the 20-plus years of my career, I worked for innovative small tech companies who were in many cases doing absolutely cutting-edge stuff. This included work on robotic telescopes, automation for the biomedical industry, microelectronic mechanical systems, and most recently wave and tidal energy. I know firsthand how much small businesses contribute, not only to the baseline of our economy, jobs, investment, revenue, but to innovation, design, and new technology. And I'm delighted to participate in this debate today to celebrate that contribution. We all want our economy to thrive. And a big part of this is finding ways for successful small businesses to scale up. There is significant benefit to the economy from a business of 50 people becoming a business of 150 people. More of our attention should be focused on businesses who are already doing well, but need support to take that next step. I would like to see targeted support to help these businesses to grow. Some of that is through setting ambitious regulation and legislation for net zero and low carbon technology. Some of that is through financial support for new equipment, machinery, and software. Some of that is through getting more young people, especially girls and women, inspired to study science, maths, engineering and technology. More people learning to weld, to wire things up, to plumb things in and to write software. More people who know how to build things, to repair things and to make things last. Whether it is designing, building or repairing, there are creative problems to solve, teams to be part of and change to bring to our country and the world. And I want young people to know that this is work that makes a difference. Much of this work will be undertaken and led by small businesses. Small businesses are embedded in their communities. Their revenue is spent locally and on the wages of local people, not squirreled away in tax havens. Small businesses contribute to our public services because they pay their taxes, that the mega corporations and multinationals are experts in dodging. The Scottish Greens have long believed that one of the best ways to support small businesses is to make sure that big businesses have to play fair. Governments must ensure that big businesses pay fair taxes, pay living wages, and clean up after themselves. The Scottish Greens know that small businesses depend on having good internet connections, good public transport links, and affordable energy. And we will continue to work for more investment in these areas. I'm looking forward to meeting with the FSB on Friday and congratulate them on their anniversary. The Scottish Greens want our economy to thrive and recognise the role of small business in this. We will continue to work towards this end and are grateful to the member for having this debate today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Slater. And I now call Stephen Kerr. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I do agree with just about everything Lorna Slater said, and I can hardly believe I'm actually saying those words. But I did. I absolutely agreed with what she was saying. And to that list of things that big businesses should do, I'd also add they should pay their bills on time and in full, and not wait businesses, small businesses, wait 60 or 90 or 120 days to pay their bills. So congratulations to Audrey Nicholl for bringing this motion to Parliament, because it is providing us with an opportunity, as I mentioned to Daniel Johnson, to talk up the importance of small businesses, and indeed medium business, to our national economy. I can honestly say that in my career in business, the greatest accelerated learning I had was when I was working for a medium-sized business in central Scotland. And there you learn, really learn, on the rock face of business, what it means to be the backbone of an economy. And I have to say that small and medium-sized businesses have some strategic advantages, and they were listed, I think, by Lorna Slater in her speech, advantages over larger businesses, because they have this ability to adapt quickly to changing market conditions, to embrace innovation with a greater degree of agility than a larger business that might find it more difficult. And Christine Graham's absolutely right about the resilience, the deep-rooted resilience there is in many small businesses. But that's not to say, as other speakers have suggested, that there aren't real challenges for small businesses, and thank goodness for organisations like the FSB in that respect, because not least of all in terms of challenges is the challenge of running the business and at the same time investing time and energy in all of the strategic things that go into running and growing a successful business. Everything from recruitment and retention to staff training, managing the cash, managing inventory, drawing up contracts and tenders. Tenders, as was mentioned earlier, a real nightmare for small businesses.
Christine Graham.
In the spirit of the debate, I have to say to Mr. Kerr, I'm in green with almost everything he says.
Stephen Kerr.
I'd knock me over with a feather. I mean, we're having unanimity. But why not? Why? This is a subject that should bring us all together, because this is the meat and drink of how we're going to grow our country's economy and become a more prosperous Scotland. And the owners and the leaders and the operators of these businesses I'm describing, that we are describing, are both generalists and specialists. And so I want to congratulate everyone connected to the world of small businesses in Scotland, because I genuinely believe, from my own experience, that they are the heroes of our economy. So let me say something to conclude about the need for us to foster entrepreneurship in our country. So many young people, the current generations, have a real flair for spotting opportunities and making they almost have an intuitive grasp about how to make the most of them. They have the gene that they need to be successful entrepreneurs. Then we need, as a number of other speakers have said, to support their aspirations by making it as easy as possible for them to set up a micro business from whatever age it is, that they first have the idea to do something. And we should do everything we can, as again other speakers have said, to encourage young entrepreneurs. They exist all around us. We need to nurture them. I have a friend who has a son barely into his teens. He's already harnessing the power of social media to monetize some of his hobbies and interests. And as a result, he's got a growing income, self-generated. And there are thousands of young people who have the capacity and the inclination to do exactly this because of the nature of the technological environment in which we now live. We need to encourage the creation of micro and small businesses, and we must make it easier, more possible, for those businesses to be scaled up through support. Small businesses need our vocal and practical support as policymakers. In closing, I want to praise the work done by many people. The FSB has been mentioned. The Chambers of Commerce have been mentioned. Business Gateway was mentioned as well. They also deserve appreciation. And there's so many other forms of grassroots support programmes. Let this Parliament resolve to become the greatest champion of Scotland's entrepreneurs. Let's see more positivity like this on all sides of this chamber to champion Scotland's small businesses.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. And I now call on Minister Richard Lochhead to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's not often we have Christine Graham agreeing with Stephen Kerr and Stephen Kerr agreeing with Lorna Slater. So firstly, can I congratulate the FSB on achieving that major milestone? And secondly, and more importantly, can I join all members, and particularly Audrey Nicholl, who's tabled this motion, for which I thank her also, on achieving their 50 years of supporting small businesses here in Scotland and indeed across these islands as well. And like many members, I, as both an MSP and as Minister, have engaged heavily with small businesses and indeed FSB, and I welcome their senior representatives to the gallery for this debate, over the years, and it's been enormous value. And Douglas Ross mentioned some of the initiatives in Moray over the years, and as constituency MSP, I very much associate myself with his comments and tribute to the FSB and their representatives as well. And of course, other members have also mentioned Mike Duncan, who's the North East Scotland Development Manager for the FSB. And last year, he took me on a tour of small businesses in Keith. We visited Square Roots, the cafe, J&E Cleaning, also the Keith Motorist DIY business and the Oogie House Hotel as well, and that was a very valuable visit to visit these important businesses in my constituency. I think Audrey Nicholl, when she mentioned small businesses in the energy sector, Lorna Slater did the same, Claire Hawkey, I think, mentioned a laser company in her constituency, and Stephen Kerr mentioned businesses in relation to social media in his area, reminds us that this is, when we talk about small businesses, we're talking about right across the Scottish economy. We're not simply talking about retail businesses on our high streets that we visit to encourage people to shop local, which I'm sure we all do, and that's a very valuable part of this debate. But, you know, small businesses are represented in all parts of the Scottish economy and doing incredible things in terms of innovation and other areas at the moment in Scotland. And as Pam Gossel has mentioned, they support communities. It's not just about supporting the economy. They're anchors in their local communities, many of these small businesses. As Daniel Johnson mentioned as well, it's very tough and lonely at times running a small business. It's extremely hard work. You have to be determined. You have to have grit. But also it is rewarding. And we have a small business community in Scotland that is resilient at the same time. So I think these are important points to make. Now, our small businesses, as other members have mentioned as well, have faced a number of significant challenges. People have mentioned the pandemic. We also, of course, know from speaking to local small businesses, rising energy bills have been a big challenge for them. The impact of Brexit, we saw Aston University just publish a report in the last few days talking about the impact of small businesses of Brexit and difficulties of exporting and so on and so forth. So these are very real challenges that the small business community have had to cope with, and of course inflation and the cost of raw materials and supplies increasing dramatically as well. The Scottish Government, of course, is not responsible for all of those challenges, but we do have some areas where we are responsible for and can be challenging. A number of members mentioned the regulatory framework and the burden of regulations and how we have to get that right. And, you know, one challenge was the role of the business and regulation impact assessments that we carry out in Scotland, known as BREEA. And the New Deal for Business, of course, commits us to improving that regulatory landscape, which can have a real impact on small business, and we very much recognise that. The FSB played a very central and constructive role in shaping our understanding as a government of the cumulative regulatory impact, and they have contributed to improving the BREEA process as well. So their diligence and partnership working with Scottish Government led to the publication of a revised BREEA, a revised impact assessment. That includes strengthening guidance for officials to consider impacts on small businesses when developing new policy or regulation. And they continue to offer balanced, considered leadership, the FSB, in terms of the subgroup on regulation and business partnership, which is also part of that agenda as well. I'll give way to
Lauren Slater.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way. Would the Minister agree that small businesses can also be supported through regulation and legislation? For example, upcoming legislation on heat in buildings would set a level playing field, for example, for business in the construction industry, so that all builders of new homes and buildings have to meet the same high standards in terms of environmental, meeting environmental standards and insulation and so on.
Richard Locke, Minister.
I do agree with the general principle, which I think is an important one that Lorna Slater expresses, because quite often businesses will approach politicians and MSPs seeking a level playing field and seeking intervention from governments to make sure that is a level playing field in particular areas of policy. So I think that the principle is a good one to mention in this debate. As a government, we have to continue to work with businesses to develop a process for identifying, considering and, if appropriate, removing regulations, however, that are no longer required. And we are looking to identify new regulations that can support business in Scotland, especially our small businesses. And the FSB are playing a crucial role in all those agendas. And after all, of Scotland's 340,760 businesses, just over 98% are small businesses, and of those, 95% are sole traders or micro-businesses. And including in that 98% are really vital sectors of the Scottish economy, like tourism and hospitality. In 2023, that sector alone comprised 13,495 registered small businesses, with employment in the small business sector there standing at 117,000 or more than that in 2022. Of course, the retail sector is another important part of our economy, and small businesses are represented heavily in that sector, and many members have mentioned the importance of shopping local and supporting our small small businesses in the retail sector as well. And that sector alone comprises over 14,000 registered businesses in 2023, which is 8.3% of Scotland's total. I think members have emphasised, as I said before, the important role that particularly shops and retailers play in our local communities and in our towns and cities, and some of the challenges that have been faced, particularly during the pandemic and post-pandemic, in our high streets. And of course, a lot of work now underway, working in partnership with local government and other local regional economic players to revitalise our town centres in Scotland for the benefit of our small businesses as well. So again, the FSP are playing a very important role in helping us move that forward as well. Clearly, I should point out, as a government, we won't always agree with everything when we have our negotiations and discussions with small businesses and the Federation of Small Business. No government would, no government will, but we do try and find some solutions to these common challenges where we can. And a final couple of points. Firstly, in terms of support, Myrtle Fraser described the Small Business Bonus Scheme as a real success story, and of course it is. and this government has put in place that policy for a number of years now. And I, as I'm sure others have, spoken to small businesses who say they would not exist if it wasn't for that small business bonus scheme. That's taken 100,000 businesses out of rates altogether. And of course, we have the services offered by Business Gateway as well. So I just want to finish by reiterating all the powerful points made by members across the chamber about the vital role played by the Federation of Small Businesses, championing and giving a strong voice to the small business community in Scotland. Congratulations once again to them in achieving their first 50 years. As an MSP, I've been here for 25 years of that, and I should say I look forward to the next 50 years of the FSB supporting Scotland's small business community.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.